Right. So this is this would be fun. This is like what would you call this? My spiritual testimony. You know, this is you know, Jedi training program, if you will, for myself. That's how it often seems. You know, around the world, I'd have these experiences, I meet these amazing people, and it was just, I was being trained for something, you know. So I'm just sort of, off the top of my head here, gonna share some of that experience, I suppose, as it comes up. Let's see, where to start? So, a lot of what I believe right now is sort of like reverse engineering. For example, I've gotten back into studying Christianity and loving Jesus, and I haven't necessarily always been this way at all. I have experiences like a few years ago while hitchhiking. I wasn't getting a ride, and I went down to this fence line down the hill, and one little tree, there was a little box thing sitting there. I sat down and started a little smoke break and found a Bible, one of the Gideon New Testaments, just literally flapping in the wind right there. Someone had left it. Well, long story short, I went up to the road and thought, well, hey, let's test this out, you know? And I used the Bible, and I flagged down the first car that came by. And, you know, when things like that happen, the mind still dismisses it. It's like random. You know, by the way, he didn't ever even saw the Bible, actually. He was a doctor, and he hadn't picked a hitchhiker up in 20 years. He actually stopped to pee in a jar, I guess, and I ran so fast with my gear, he just, you know, he thought, well, you know, why not, right? So that wasn't even a known spiritual experience on his behalf. But anyway, a couple years later, I have a girlfriend that's never hitchhiked before, and while we're hitchhiking, we're at the spot, we don't get a ride, we end up staying in the area, which is cool. It was a really beautiful old house there with the windmill and stuff. And anyway, the next day, We're trying again. 3-4 hours go by, nothing happens. Oh, we remember the Bible. We grab the Bible out. Sure enough, 2-3 cars stop. You know, it takes not the first one, but 2-3 cars. Bam. After all these hours, and we get in, and we start to talk, and the guy's like, he's a young kid, and he's like, I don't know how you guys feel about all this, but you know, I I picked you guys up because God told me I should pick you up. And he looked at us, and me and my girlfriend at the time, we looked at each other, and we're like, that's not weird at all. Like, here's the story. We showed him the Bible, and, you know, we had church. You know, it says in the Bible that anytime two or more gather and talk about God, that's church. So in a way, I guess this is sort of a church, you know? So for me, it's, you know, still the mind can dismiss these things, but when you experience these small miracles, it can give you goosebumps and chills, make you cry at times. Keep in mind that, you know, free will is a gift, and God can't impose on our free will. It doesn't impose on our free will. Like, a sign can't come down right now with neons like, God is real, God is real. It might be a little too much. So it like skates the line of our free will, but still wants us to acknowledge the truth or eternity or our relationship with God. God loves us and has mercy for us. It's a intelligent design, according to science. I believe in science as well. But anyway, so let's talk about some of this spirit science, if you will. When they say, Seek ye first the kingdom of heaven and all his righteousness, and everything else, all these other things will come to you, right? What this means to me, it's really about when you have complete focus on God, if you will, or creator, or this higher intelligence of our Father, you are using your free will to say that, you know, when you're in our will, when you're using your own will, we are saying that, okay, I'm gonna think of my own life. You know, I'm gonna go to school for this. I'm gonna get this job. I'm gonna make this much money a month. I'm gonna, you know, afford this car. And we plan out our own lives, our own will. Well, we can use our will also to give it up to the Most High, and then we'll be guided. We can be vessels then, and these other things that we want will come to us in miraculous ways when we start doing God's work, or we start being guided. You know, we step out of our own lives, and the sincerity of this, the authenticity of your relationship to your creator, makes it so all these other things end up coming to you anyway. You know, but it's a weird trick. It's like a cosmic joke. It's like an emotional when you unattach yourself from it is when you get it. You know, it's like, it's a kind of funny thing, because it's like, to want something, you're supposed to not want it, and then, you know, it'll come to you, maybe, you know, but you can't do it for that, because, you know, the spirit world knows that. And so that's what all the vision quests, or the rites of passage are, fasting, meditation, prayer, all these things, they are that process of seeking ye first the kingdom. And also this happens every moment, because you can give your life up and then just 5 seconds later take it back by making your own decision. So the concept in the spiritual discipline is to be in constant meditation, constant prayer. Always be conscious of that relationship that's, you know, that is the source of all things, you know, the one pinpointed cause and effect, the one that we can blame for all of this, you know. And what I mean is, like, through science we can study how it's done forever and find out forever and ever more and more cosmic riddling riddles of scientific math equations that go, you know, two buses long, you know. But it's all gonna go back to, okay, with the Big Bang, who made the Big Thing? Big Bang, you know. It's like, you know, all energy has to come from something. So there's always this, like, this philosophical debate about, you know, if God is real. Talking with me right now, you gotta understand that when I was 19 years old, I'm now 40 years old, I started hitchhiking. And, you know, many times I had money, sometimes I didn't. There's times I had money along the way and run out, you know, because you meet these sort of, like, faith-based lifestyle people. A lot of them, you know, are international scene people. They've traveled a lot, they've hitchhiked, and different things. And so, you know, I met these kind of people and they got me going on it. But I definitely have done, I got film on it. I'd love to share it with you. It's like how would you put it? So for me, what I'm learning is that even when you step out of your comfort zone, and even you don't understand how things work out, as long as you're supposed to be alive, you'll watch the universe can try little miracles to make sure you survive, because it's not your time yet, you know. So through your free will, you can, you know, what we learn when we travel around is you just can just, like, wow, step out of your comfort zone, get into the unknown, and an amazing life unfolds. All these people you didn't even know exist, all of a sudden you're, like, friends with them, and you're exploring real estate and beautiful places like you've never could imagine, and you're just in awe of it. And it's like, all you did is stepped out of your mind, you know, what you thought was real. And so many times I think, you know, I felt real lucky that I had this faith-based lifestyle, because otherwise, you know, I would have stayed in places, because I didn't feel like I had enough money to do what I wanted to do. But luckily I knew about hitchhiking, and luckily I knew about just not worry about it and have faith. And, you know, and time after time after time after time again, you know, like, I went to, like, 11 countries in Europe, you know, for like half a year, and then 3 months in Mexico, you know, with a girlfriend. And, you know, yeah, my girlfriend and that I hitchhiked Europe with, me and her moved to Maui for 5 years. We had a baby in Austin right when we got back from Europe, and raised Satori for 3 years on Maui, and now they live in Texas. But that was a whole nother set of miracles, you know. So for me, all the hitchhiking around the world, you know, the living in LA now for 10-11 years, Maui for 5 years, the film business, you know, I've been able to take success through that. I've been able to get autographs and, you know, and get pictures with strangers and have all kinds of fun little hookups and stuff from that. And that was cool. And, you know, the best part about that was is how the movie, the Craigslist Joe that was in everything, we got props on helping people make better life decisions. You know, I got told through people that met me and the emails and stuff that people were able to get out of, you know, bad jobs and cities sometimes and hit the road and just all kinds of stuff. And they were really inspired by the movie, and that made me feel that that's what it's all worth. And also was the completion of sort of like the hippie pipe dream, if you will. For many years, I knew that for me, my purpose was to, you know, I've been giving my life to God since I was, you know, a teenager, really. And that process, it took me out of kind of the religious side of it, the church of it, and I got spiritual, the new agey hippie movement, you know, and God isn't everything, and, you know, name Satori, Satori, and I still believe truth is everywhere and everything. That's that's real neat to see, actually. But you know, I have been sort of on a spiritual quest the whole time. And yeah, how about this? Some random facts about the Bible and what I've learned in my research last couple years on Jesus. So the Bible itself is a collection of 1600 years of writing by 44 authors. There's they're all Jewish, by the way. There's about 300. I've even read somewhere else they said 500. So there's like 300 to 500 prophecies. Almost all of those have come true. I mean, we're at the end of the book now. I mean, that's crazy. If you think about it, it wouldn't even be here if the first, the Old Testament, right? Which are many religions book. They all, most of the major religions study the Old Testament. It's funny. So anyway, so if that book prophesies Jesus coming, right? If that book hadn't prophesied Jesus, then the New Testament wouldn't happen. There would be nothing going on with any of the books. All those wouldn't even matter. But the fact is that this Bible, that when Jesus came, was already a Bible. When he was a little kid, 11, 12 years old, whatever, they couldn't find him. He was, you know, doing some scripture reading with some cats up at the place, and he said, "I'm doing my father's work." He was quoting the Bible. See, that it was already a Bible. That Bible, the Old Testament now, prophesized his birth and coming. That's what the New Testament is. So without some massive prophecy happening, it wouldn't even happen. And so since the Bible has been out even then, way before the Catholics got to the Old Testament, you couldn't change it. There's so many transcripts, so many Bibles in play. When the Catholics came out with the Bible, we know of the canonized version, they left books out, like Enoch's book, they left Mary Magdalene's book out, they left Thomas's book out, things like this, which tell a much more in-depth story about what happened. It's not the Bible's changed, it's just incomplete, you see. For a long, long time, we didn't have access to the other books, but they support the same thing that the books we have. But anyway, so what you have is, like I say, 300 prophecies, 300, almost all of them come true. The first one is, and this is very interesting here, the first prophecy of the Bible is within a few pages of it. It's in Genesis. It says, the God's talking to Old Slick, you know, the devil, whatnot. And he says, because of what you've done, referring to the fruit, you know, thing with Adam and Eve, because of what you've done, you will crawl on the mud and eat from the dirt, and you and her will be it. Your offspring and her offspring will be have enmity, or will be enemies, and she will bore him who will bruise your head, and you will bruise thy heel. Which basically means the human DNA will going to birth the second coming of Christ, which is going to stop him. Now, I don't know how that's one person or through the sky, how that all happens, but that's basically what seems like the war on humanity is right now. He was cast down to this place, him and the fallen angels, and so we sort of like are here now, and so all this Bible stuff, if you look around, is deeply enriched in our history. It's like, it wouldn't exist. So many people have tried to test it, but since it's come out, even the Catholic version, has been, so many transcripts have been made, and so many have been made since the very time it came out, that anybody that's tried to change it, you know, those books have been bashed to the wayside as fakes. There's two known since it's been around. You see, so it's like a code, and that's what's called when people refer to the living word of God. And what that means is that when you do the right work and you study it proper, it speaks to you personally. It teaches you the revelation, meaning. And it's like a cosmic game, and it's like a Scrabble or something. It's like, oh, you got all these letters, blah, blah, blah. You read it and you're not into it. And it's like, oh, this is dumb, and you don't even look at it, you know? And all that goes into, basically, you know, the concept of what's happened. It's like the fall of mankind. If you really want to, you know, let's talk about that. It's like the fall of mankind. We're born into a fallen race. So for whatever happened, which is symbolic, or, you know, however you want to look at it, you know, Adam and Eve, however it happened, we fell from grace, and we're born into it. So it's like, not only have we done it, not only have we been born into it, but we've also done it personally, because, you know, if you can look at it one way, it's like the habits of sin, perhaps, and sin means to fall off the mark. And so let's just look at that real quick. You know, that's just, well, for me, how, you know, refer, how I'm seeing it is like to fall off the mark. That's the original translation. So it's like for life, for eternal life, if we didn't fall off the mark, if we're thinking to prolong life and have a long life, if we're acting to live a long, long life, like, you know, they say we used to live to be 1,000 years old. What if we live better lives, make better decisions right now? Our bodies could be 120, 80, 100, 500,000 years old. Who knows, you know? And maybe this, this whole thing is not only just symbolic or somehow meaning of eternal life, but also physical life too. So like the sin, you know, it's like to eat 5 pounds of cake every day. It's like, oh, you're sinning, it's like a judgment. It's like, oh, you're unhealthy, you know, kind of thing. It's like it goes into these types of dynamics. So, you know, so we take on these habits of our society, and then we take on, and then we heard the word, like we've heard this stuff our whole lives, you know, that we shouldn't do these things, and God wrote these down through the inspired word of these other people, and there's these books and say these rules, and so we consciously say, yo, okay, that's what God told me to do, when we do them, do anyway. And so we become sinners inadvertently, not just, you know, karmically born into it, which is also true. So there we are, we're dead, we're born dead, and only some people get saved. And that's fucked up. And people from the outside look in the religion, say, why would I want to be a part of religion? In which it says, I'm one of the people go to hell, or not a lot of people go to hell, and only some people go to heaven. Well, I know that's hard to take, but that's what it says is going on. And so if you look around, many call for your children. Many people don't really even talk about this, know about this, want to talk about this, or go on to them, go vision quests. They won't like take no money and hit up a mountain and stay for 4 days and fast and just say, like, God, show yourself to me, go to monasteries, all these things you got to do to really pop your head open, to really find God, what makes you cry and stuff. It's like, okay, so who are the ones that get it? And, you know, the teachers are the people who get it, or whatnot, you know, they, the guru types or whatever, or whatever they may be, or whatever, people, even Western types write books or whatnot. The teacher can only talk about how they found it through their individual path. They can show you the path, but you, even if you walk that path and then two others, you might not get it. It's a random thing. It's not based on intelligence or money or any of these things. Some people get the pop and some people don't. So what is that? Well, that goes into ancient debates, man. There's, you know, the predestination or predetermination. So predestination, predetermination has to do with free will. Do you have free will? And then one of them has to do with, do God have his chosen ones, and do we have any say in that? And both sides is, you know, supported philosophically and biblically on the side of predeterminism, which is the question of, does God have his favorites and does everyone else stand? Well, the concept goes like this. So, basically, the moment that we think that we, you know, we're going to just be able to, when we're done doing what we want to do, we're going to make our deathbed or whatever. Hey, you can go knock on the door. Hey, God, I'm sorry. I love you, Jesus. And we're just going to get into heaven. It's like, because as soon as we proclaim it, that's cool. You just got to believe. I believe you now. Boom, you're in. Well, what about this? Like, what about the fact that, you know, we sinned against him. So it would be him, you know, our God, our Father, whatever, who would create the rules of reconciliation. It's, you know, this is a real personal relationship. You know, we've cheated on God in so many ways. And so, you know, to believe that is, goes along to the doctrine with saying that we get in heaven through our works, that we can somehow earn our way back in heaven. When a true doctrine is supposed to be that we are saved by grace, that we are sinners, we're always going to be sinners, and that it's through the mercy and grace of God that we are saved in the first place. Those of us that feel that way, I get it. And so what I'm saying is that according to this concept, it means that that very moment that you even get thirsty or excited or interested in something spiritual, it makes you want to meditate, or there's times you do open up the Bible after picking it up before and you're like, oh, this is dumb, I don't want to read this at all, this is, and then you do read it and you get something amazing out of it, he's like, wow, and you want to read it more, and there's periods you might want to, man, I just want to go sneak off somewhere where you read the Bible and stuff like that. And I know a lot of different people have those periods and stuff, you know, like what they're saying is that this is grace, this is, you're touched by Holy Spirit that it's gifted to you from God to even give you the thirst for it in the first place. And that if we even do have any choice in it, it's at this point that once we're touched or once we're given the chance or felt it, the desire for it, we follow it, we jump on it, we like, oh wow, we nurture it, you know. We, it's like a relationship. So, you know, think about it like that. Like, so if it's a relationship, then just like anyone you know in real life, even a lover or something, if you go running off cheating or whatever, you come back whenever you decide to come back, knocking, oh, I'm coming home, I'm sorry. You know, that person's going to be in the doghouse. You have to do something special. It's like the person who's letting you back into their house is the one who dictates the reconciliation, you see? Doesn't go the other way around. And if you do come back saying, no, I'm going to get into my rules, and I don't want to come in. Well, I went and mowed the lawn, and, you know, I watered the flowers, and see, I did good deeds, and I told the neighbors, you've been a good wife, now let me back in. You know, that doesn't work like that. You know that. You know, you're going to have to really, truly, you know, find out what that individual person's needs are with your relationship, and spend time and nurture. And if that person does let you back in, you got to do special things to reconcile that relationship. And we have the most dearest, deepest, intimate relationship with our Creator. I mean, it's like everything we have forgotten is from this one source, this one person. I mean, it's like once you find God, you just want to serve God. I mean, me personally, I've traveled around the world. Me personally, like, I've been to 15, 16 countries. I've met all kinds of amazing, beautiful people. Like, this is real to me. These principles are what I've used to travel the world. I mean, this isn't no hokey pokey stuff. This is how I've become a world traveler. This is how I've made my dreams real. This is how I've done things as an artist and as a filmmaker. I mean, when it comes down to it, I mean, yeah, I mean, I get very confident about this because this isn't no, this isn't some, you know, hippy dippy, blah, 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 hearsay stuff. This is how I've accomplished what I've accomplished for 20 years. And I've considered myself a minimalist, a entrepreneur minimalist, you see, like, by lowering my emotional overhead, there's very little I need. My art supplies, you know, I love my van. That's what I'm doing right now. I'm able to sit here in the rain, be by myself and do this. There's, you know, a lot of situations I've been in, I would not be able to do this right now. So here I am. Booyah. You know, so that's what, so back to that. So what's happening right now is we are in postmodernism. You see, postmodernism is basically saying that the truth is relative. It's because modernism is very exact truth, and we feel like that so many, like, oh, my religion's right and your religion's wrong and blah, blah, blah. That's created such conflict. And so now we live in a reaction to that, which is postmodernism, which is now, oh, everyone's truth is your own truth and your truth is different than my truth, and so it's all relative. And that's the worldview, which is that's, you know, it's cool, that's fine. But there's a deeper meaning to it, or a reaction that it has, and that's this. Okay, so what that does is it supports pluralistic ways of thinking, relativism. It supports this belief system that if you can pick and choose what your spiritual practice is or what your spiritual belief is, then, you know, you can go to this religion, pick this out. You know, you can pick this out for this religion, this doctrine, or this concept, and then you basically, again, create your list of rules for reconciliation, and you happen to have a God that doesn't mind you sleeping in or smoking cigarettes here on the side or blah, 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 or a glass of wine, blah, blah, blah. We end up not really doing the spiritual work it takes to really find God and have that relationship happen. You see, you know, it's like people who go through this process go through stepping out of their own comfort zone physically, mentally, emotionally. You got to go to ashrams, wake up 4 o'clock in the morning, freaking take a cold bath, cold shower, freaking meditate for two, three hours, or get lost in some foreign land and lose half your money and not know where you're going to be staying and can't talk to people and just like get past your comfort zone. These things are real processes. These things really, you know, are part of this external, internal process you have to go through. You can't experience it through a book. You can't experience it through a movie. You can't experience it through understanding the concepts of it, you see, you know. So what I'm getting at is that this relativism or this pluralistic way of thinking is dangerous. It's the difference that when Christianity came, you know, this monotheistic religion, what was popular at the time, the Romans were, they're pluralistic, their relativism, their pagan religion had many gods. They had, you know, fickle, all these different gods and many different, you know, polytheistic religions. They're human. You got to sacrifice things to them. They get fickle, they get mad. You got to, so the example of when Christianity came, this was a form of an all-perfect, all-powerful God that doesn't break promises, doesn't break covenants. An example of perfection that we can emulate through him being born into the flesh as his son and giving us an example through his life, his story, and his legacy. You know, people can say what they want. Just read the red letters. Just read what he says. You read those parables to me, like, let's get together. You want to debate this whole thing. You want to tell me God's in everything, but it's not a religion. God's in everything, but it's not in the church. Come on, man. You know what I'm saying? Like, bam, it's all right here. See what I'm saying? It's like, so what happens with this is that you start to have, through Jesus Christ, you see, the blood of Jesus Christ is this. You always hear about, oh, you know, we're saved through the blood of Jesus Christ. Well, what this means is that he bought the deed back for humanity by coming down to the earth, the place of his enemy, and in his enemy got to crucify him, got to beat him horribly, do this horrible atrocities to him, defile him, and kill him. And it's like almost like, you know, it's like, okay, well, I want to buy the deed back for my people. And he, you know, probably held his finger, you know, crossed his fingers behind his back, said, sure, pal, you can have whatever you want. And he came and so, but what happened was, what he couldn't stop, no physical power, because it's like old Slick only has power over physicality. He can only tempt us with stuff. He can't make you do anything. He's tempting us, he's tricking us the whole time. And he only has power, physical power, just power over the stuff, like, you know. Think about all the senses, all the sins, all the sensory stuff, it's the fleshual stuff, you know. So what he wasn't able to account for is that without God doing any hokey pokey stuff, without him doing any special magic, just him using the rules within the earth already, you see, by him being born into the flesh like he was and being crucified, fulfilling, see, being born in the flesh like he was able to do it to fulfill prophecy. And that's a whole other topic of how he did that. Many key points that if you really study it, that there's no way it could have otherwise happened. You see? So, by this happening, he came back through the resurrection, which he came back for 40 days, six times he shown himself. First time was Mary Magdalene. You know, she was a big part of the church for at least 100, 150 years, by the way. The first part of the church was started by her, by the way. You know, the canonized version we have excluded her because the Catholics are not true to this doctrine that we're talking about. But anyway, so what happened is through this resurrection, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people saw him. You know, now we see it through the records. It's all records too. He lived. This whole notion that he didn't exist is only 150 years old. I mean, it's nonsense. Like, his story is filled with examples of non-Christian talking about him, like Theodius, I think his name is, some super reputable Roman historian has talked about him. I mean, it's definitely he existed. Definitely Romans kept books of who they killed. Four of his disciples were killed, four martyred for Jesus Christ, that he was resurrected. So here's what I'm trying to say, that the conviction of the people who saw him resurrected, of the people who started the church, people that were like there alive, being like, no, I saw him. Many people got martyred for it, different ways, persecuted. The last disciple to live was 84 years old. And so if you think about it, for 100 years, there were people that lived that told a firsthand account of seeing the resurrected Christ. And that, my friend, is what started the Christian church. By the time 200, 300 came around, they couldn't stop it, because that true conviction, one-on-one account that got so many people going, is why you see the Romans did this flip from having their religion, you know, the polytheistic religion happen. And so what they did is they mixed the two, and that's our modern day, you know, Christianity with Easter, which is Easter. You know, it's like a pagan thing. What are we talking about? These, you know, bunnies and eggs and stuff. It's ridiculous. That's not, what does it got to do with anything? Like Christmas, all stuff. They're, you know, they just mix their pagan religion. They got a bunch of idols and stuff. That's false idols. That's not real Christianity. I mean, it goes deeper than that. But anyway, you know, so what you see there is there's been many people. I mean, there's people all over who think they're Jesus. They take too many drugs. There's not houses everywhere, you know. And there's a special place for people who think they're God and stuff like that. I mean, just because some dude thought he was God or whatever don't mean that he's going to get as big as he did. That's the only thing that what could happen like that is the true power of creation, the power of God, manifestation. I mean, look around how big the church got. Look how the history of the world evolves around. I mean, what day is it? It's 2017. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's Jesus' birthday. What year was it when he was born? It was a year. It wasn't zero. People are like, what year is it? Oh, it's zero. All of a sudden, no, it was a year. I don't know what it was. See what I'm saying? He reset time. It's not Buddha's birthday. It's not Allah's birthday. It's Jesus' birthday. Jesus Christ, boom, 2017. That's powerful. See what I'm saying? Like, this is like spread. Like, okay, well, what about, like, you got to know about Jesus. You got to understand about, okay. People say that's ludicrous that you have to do Jesus, because what if you don't know about Jesus? And then, you know, that's messed up. If you don't know about Jesus, you're gonna go to hell. Well, first of all, I want to ask a question. Like, who hasn't heard about Jesus at this point? Show me somebody. Find me someone around you. Say, have you never heard about Jesus in your life? And you walk them to me now, and I'd like to meet that person. And that's powerful, because you know what I'm talking about. Like, it manifested like all around the world. Like I say, the Catholics did a lot of murder and stuff like that, and it's interesting how, if you think of the battle of you know, allegiance or whatever, the dark forces would want to influence the church and turn people off to Jesus or to God, and maybe the Catholic Church is one of them institutions that has very subtly turned people against, you know, Christianity by doing so much of the murders and doing so much of these things that makes outsiders not like the church, you know? Just a theory, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, the thing is so what you have is when he did this, right? So the blood of Jesus Christ, he died for our sins, means this. And because he's been able to manifest himself in everybody's life, and we all have had access to this manual, the Bible, that is the inspired word of God, and that we're supposed to be, and it is okay to trust all of it and get out of it what we want, and we're never gonna be perfect, no, but we use it to guide ourselves. And it's a judgment of our hearts that when we judge whether we die or the judgment day would happen, it's the trueness of our hearts that we knew the manual. We did our best to adjust our lives, because we're rewarded as we do it anyway, because the bliss that we get along the way for being spiritually clean feels good, you know? So it's like that. So through him doing what he did, now it's like somebody has gone around to every plantation, every cotton field in the world, and said, hey, I have bought your deed. I've bought your freedom. Everyone here, you can come with me now if you like. If you want to, come over here right now. Grab this manual, this book here. This is what I want you to do, but you're free from this plantation. And the plantation is like the jungle rule. It's all these things material. In the secular world, it's all these things, you know, get mine, me and mine, get money, dominate, lie, cheat, steal, whatever. You know, that thing, which is half the world, it seems, you know, it's like half the story, you know. And then through these religions, or somebody like Jesus Christ or the Bible, it's like, okay, the road is narrow. Here's these list of rules, which seems controlling, you know. And when I was young, it did seem controlling. But what happens is all these physical things become only temporary satisfaction. And then you just want to do more and more and more. And they don't last as long. So you got to keep doing more. You got to find money to do all these things. And then you're in bondage to it. And then it don't even get you the same buzz as it used to. And there's a craziness in that, and bondage in that. But then when we free ourselves from these things and you just get high through, you know, and is eating with somebody around you and praying and meditating and just like high off life, like that becomes freedom. And that becomes, you know, the trickery. And it's like, oh, the things that we do in freedom end up creating bondage. And then when we find freedom from these things, then it's like, oh, wow, fun. There you go. And then we start to appreciate these rules or these guidelines or these, you know, all the things we learn in scripture and that's why the road is narrow and very, you know, spiritually out people, man. They're all the hip cats, if you think about it, they're doing a lot of disciplined things. They have special diets, or they meditate every day, somehow 2 hours a day, just yogas and all these different things. You know, that's why it's like a, you know, especially, you know, when you really do have the freedom to check out all the material things. And that's one thing I've been able to learn in LA and love about LA. I've been able to taste of all the luxurious things that you could have in life and meet some really amazing, outstanding people. You know what I mean? I've got to hang out with Jim Carrey, Robin Williams. You know, Robin Williams called me T. You know, that was pretty cool. Jim Carrey told me stories about the day he got put on TV, you know? That was super incredible. And I was so happy that I was working. I didn't think I was getting to see him. I heard he was going to be at the Comedy Store that night, but he ended up coming to the sound booth where I was at, you know? That was super, super cool. But, you know, I've had all kinds of, I've had amazing stuff happen to me in LA. The whole time, my intention was to be in LA to help, you know, work myself into the film business, but also to, as my influence in the film business, to do positive things, to create inspiring video, that movies, content, comedy that was going to overall help people, you know, positive content, healthy content, things that are driven to, you know, help people achieve their dreams and become the people they want to be, you know? So, let's go back to some other points, perhaps some more Jedi training PowerPoint kind of concepts, I think. Like, how about, well, this concept I've been working with, how about this? I'll give it to you now. It's called the profitability of presence. I'm working sort of on a book on this. Not sort of at all, but sort of mean slowly. So, okay, the profitability of presence. My cup is overflowing way of life. It's the way that 37 minutes now. It's a way that I can speak for 37 minutes here. And if anybody is still listening to this, I'm just like, here's some beatnik. So I can't clap because I'm holding a microphone. But anyway, so this is cool. If you listen to this, I think it's something worth it. What I discovered is this philosophy that's called the my cup is overflowing way of life. And what I learned through things like hitchhiking all over, is that when I was present with people and I wasn't concerned about my needs, I wasn't, had fear of my survival. When I was hitchhiking, I was alongside the road, these people picked me up, and all that's in the back of me, I don't really care. I'm interested in learning this person and meeting this person. So, hi, you know, what's your name? Where are you from? What do you do? It's good asking questions, keeping conversation. And after this process, you know, there'd be very wild times, like meet a doctor or something, and you know, after a little bit, he confided in me, like, you know, actually, you know, I'm on the drugs I'm prescribing, man. I've been cheating on my wife, I don't even know what to do, it's crazy. And then I would facilitate some friendship for them and say the right things that a friend would say, and I'd be like, wow, that's really cool, that's nice, man. What's your name, Travis? And wow, so what are you doing, man? What do you plan on staying anyway, man? How much money do you, how do you live? Like, sometimes I had money, and if I had money, I'd be like, ah, I got $400 right now. Sometimes I had 12, and I'd be like, oh, I got $12, man. You want to sleep wherever you let, drop me off, man. Find somewhere in the bushes or something. And have a tent. You know, it depends on the terrain, you know? Have a bedroll. I'm like, wow, no way. Sometimes they'd take me to new campsites that locals know. Sometimes I get to go to places. Sometimes they'd put hotels up. They pass money out sometimes if I didn't have any money. You know what I mean? All the time, very consistently, all I ever asked for was a ride, and then everything else I ever needed came to me, you know? But really, it was that the profitability of presence, and it was having a rich attitude. My attitude is my cup is overflowing, so instead of having my cup half empty and sitting there with them trying to think about easing a question in because I'm not really concerned with what they're saying, I just really want to find a way to ask them for something. Than that, people feel that. It's like, oh, hey, how are you? How's the kids? How's work? Yeah, hey, can I get $50? You know what I mean? Like that is, we sense that, and that's not how we manifest things. Because, you know, if it's like with the law of attraction, is what you pack comes back to you. So if you're wealthy, a wealthy, energetic person is going to have, they're going to be looking at you and looking for ways to share with you, you know, all kinds of ways. They're going to be sharing with you advice if they're, You don't get that wisdom. You know, a very wealthy, well-rounded person would have wisdom for you. They're listening to things you like. If you mention horses or something, like, oh, wow, well, we have 12 horses at the ranch. You should come out at the weekend. We could ride them around, you know, on the 120 acres, you know? Like, that's, you know, it's energetic. So if you don't need to have money to be wealthy in the inside. It's when you're there and able to listen to people and be someone's friend. I mean, that's worth more than anything you can share with that person. If you give someone a great conversation, a truly great conversation, it's worth more than that meal they spend on you, even if it's sushi. Shoot, man, if I spend an extra 60, 70 bucks on my sushi dinner to share with you, but you gave me some advice for my life about going to school, my wedding, you know, about the wife, or like, you know, like the kids, or something that changed my life, my career, you know what I mean? Like, wow, man. That's priceless kind of stuff, you know? So that's something you can start to do now, we can all do now. And the more I got to practice that, the more it became relevant, because then you have a confidence about yourself, because you affect people's lives in a certain way, and that gives you confidence. Even though you always get to talk about it, but you know, you went to bed many nights going, wow, that was really cool. That person was really stoked that we had that conversation today, you know? So, yeah, so there you go. How about that? 41, 49, 41 seconds. So, we're at 42 minutes, and that's what we're going to end it at. We're going to stop that right there and call that a sesh. How about that?
Some food for thought. I don't know what you're talking about. Some, you know, I did. Yeah,
I could stop it with that, because I did. You used this for the first one and the second one, huh? Got that other one for the second one. Anyway, yeah. Some food for thought with a cocoon. I love you all. Bye-bye.